a key witness, a district attorney, and a hitman on the trail. Gene Hackman stars in her late Saturday night movie, Narrow Margin, at 11:30. Now though, Lauren Bacall and Olivia Newton-John are just a couple of tonight's guests with Michael Parkinson.
These lips were made for talking. That's what they like to do. Hang about. You might find out they can say something nice about you.
Prudential, sponsors of Parkinson.
Thank you. On the show tonight, three women who defy the modern concept of celebrity by being intelligent, strong-minded, and most of all, exceedingly talented. They are the peerless Lauren Bacall, the evergreen Olivia Newton-John, and my first guest, who is most easily described as multi-talented. She's a comedian, a writer of musicals, best-selling author, actress, and the sexiest grandma in the business. Monty, you made me feel very much at home.
Oh, I can make you feel more at home.
Oh, I don't understand.
But listen, I can ask, you know, I can keep asking you testing questions all night.
Yeah, you can, you know.
No, he can't. Parky is just playing with him like a silver-haired mongoose with an overweight cobra.
The fact is, she's mad. No one's safe. Only recently, she married her grandson. Ladies and gentlemen, Meera, Syal. Do you intend to grow old outrageously like Grandma there?
Oh, yeah. I think it's the only way, really.
Isn't it? Yeah. Wonderful to be free as that and not care.
That's, I mean, she was based on a lot of older Indian women that were exactly like that.
Really?
Yeah, like my grandmas were like that, and all the widows that I'd met particularly, because all their lives they'd been somebody's mother, somebody's sister, somebody's wife, and then once everyone had died, they were the only ones left and thought, right, I'm going to have a good time now. Done it all.
Blame them.
Yeah.
Talking about having a good time, what about this marriage then? You kept that quiet, didn't you?
We did. We decided to keep it very private. Very unlike Indian tradition, because generally it's 800 people, flamethrowers, elephants, you know, the whole lot.
It's an interesting, wasn't it, that you and Sanjeev got together because you've known each other for years and years and years.
Yeah. I suppose it happened on a flight to Australia, actually. We were being sent over to do some promotion for the Kumars at 42, which has done very well over there. And what can I say? It's a really long flight. And, you know, after five vodkas, anybody looks interesting. It was either him or the Malaysian air steward, so I thought, all right, go on then.
We didn't join the Mile High Club, did we?
Not with my arthritis.
No, of course. But what about the wedding itself? I mean, it's a very expensive business doing a traditional Indian wedding, isn't it? I mean, it costs the bride's father fortunes.
Oh, a fortune, yes. I mean, officially, dowry is supposed to be illegal, actually, but it still goes on, and generally it is the bride's family. And, you know, the average Indian wedding, I think they worked it out, costs about £30,000 or something.
Truth.
Amazing.
Yeah.
Because, you know, it's not just immediate family. It's like, we have to invite the Agarwals. The Agarwals, we went to their son's christening. So they have to come. Plus, of course, their cousins are over from India. That's 73 extra people. So it just builds and builds and builds. And it's all about keeping face. And, you know, we have to invite all those people whose functions we've been to over the years. So, the average Indian wedding is not only huge, but there's at least half the people. You have no idea who
they are.
No. This is my accountant. Hi, nice to meet you. This is my mechanic. Very nice to meet you. So, you know, the opposite of that. I mean, it's what we wanted. I think
yes. You
want to remember what the day is about.
Absolutely.
And you can't do that if you've got a media circus going on. So
you went to India?
Yes.
Well, and that was to celebrate the wedding?
Yeah, we had a family reception over there.
What do you feel like when you go to India? You weren't born in India, but of course your roots are very strong there. Does it? What does it stir in you?
Diarrhea.
I was looking for a romantic answer there. Like, you know, I feel my tap roots and that sort of thing, but no diarrhea, I see, all right.
No, fine. It's fantastic, you come back so much thinner. It's like having colonic irrigation for free. Oh, no, it's all kinds of sentimental, nostalgic things, you know, it's...
Do you feel at home?
Well, yes, partly. I mean, there's a part of you that thinks, actually, you know, Britain is my home and this is where I have a niche and I'm really happy there. But there's a, you know, there's a sentimental part of you, the same part that even if you're, you know, you're Italian and have lived in Britain for many generations, when Italy play football, you're rooting for Italy. It's that nostalgic bit of you that's your motherland that there's always a pull there. You can't explain it, really.
Yes. A thing that we've explored in a lot of your work as a writer is this kind of duality of the second generation immigrant here. I mean, your parents came over here and I sort of lived the life that they would live in their own country, in a sense.
Yeah.
And you, the new generation, were subject to many more influences. So you said you lived a life in your own house and you lived another life outside. It must be odd to have that kind of schizophrenia, that sort of duality of character.
It is. It's also incredibly amusing.
Yes.
And very creative, I have to say. I mean, my theory is that all artists are outsiders in some way. You talk to anybody that's got some kind of artistic streak, even if they're living in the village where their families have been for generations, there is something different about them. They have this ability to slightly stand outside everything.
Yes.
And I think every artist needs that third objective eye, as it were.
Yes.
And being the child of immigrants, I had that built in because I belonged, yet I didn't belong.
Yes.
So I was always looking at the bigger picture. I was always looking at the outside. And I think that was the root of my, not only my creativity, but I think a lot of my British Asian generation have gone into the expressive arts. Because, you know, we made schizophrenia an art. We made telling stories an art. We made pulling on masks wherever we were an art. So naturally, you know, we now...
So why should you not become an actress and a writer?
Quite right.
Exactly, for perfect preparation. But what about your parents' generation? I mean, there's a clash there, isn't there? Because, I mean, particularly with someone like you who actually opens up yourself to the public. I mean, you go and you act, you do things on stage and you do things on television, which you then present to the public and your parents. Now, then the outside life then comes into their parlour, doesn't it?
It does, generally successfully, although there have been a couple of occasions where it was quite difficult to bridge that gap. One was a film I did called Sammy and Rosie Get Laid.
Mm-hmm, I remember that.
You can probably infer what that was about from the title. and it was actually a great team. It was Stephen Frears, it was Hanif Quraish's follow-up to Beautiful Laundrette. We all thought it was would be a huge success, and it wasn't. But in it, I played a rampaging lesbian. So I, in fact, spent most of the film with my tongue down another woman's throat, in between swearing profusely in Punjabi. And luckily, because it didn't do that well, it didn't really go nationwide. And I thought, phew, the family's never going to see that. That's fine. And then I noticed it about a year later was coming up on Channel 4 very, very late. And I thought, Channel 4, they won't be watching that. It's midnight. That's fine. Anyway, didn't think about it. On the day of transmission, get a phone call. Hello, darling. Hi, Mom. Your film is on tonight. We're all going to be watching it. The entire neighbourhood is coming around. So I just thought, well, I can't get out of this. So I kind of spent the evening taking tranquilizers, and they dealt with it in the usual Indian way, which is it was never mentioned again.
Well, I'll tell you what, they'll be very proud of your latest offering, which is going out in BBC in May time, which is an adaptation of a novel you wrote called Life Is Not All Ha Ha He He. And it's a story of three Asian girls, the kind of girls like you are that we've been talking about, who've been brought up in England, the conflict of the cultures, if you like. And it's about their relationship and it's about an act of betrayal that affects all their lives. I've seen the first episode, it's, as I said, adapted from your novel, and it's one of three. I think it's wonderful.
Okay.
I really do. I mean, it's touching, it's funny, above all. And what's more, you actually care about the people in it. How did you get the idea for this story? What was it? Was there something that triggered off in your mind? I must write about that.
Yeah, there was a very definite trigger, actually. I was reading an Asian newspaper, and there were two headlines literally side by side. And one headline said, British Asian women top the UK graduate league. And I thought, fantastic, we're doing so well. And right next to it was the headline, British Asian women top the self-harm and suicide league. And it was mind-blowing and so stark to see those two.
Yeah.
Yes, those two statistics. And I thought, what's going on with us that we have the ability to be so successful and an equal ability to destroy ourselves?
Yes.
There's obviously something going on. So I really had a kind of hard look at my own life, which was going through some turmoil, and the lives of my friends. And I just wanted to explore really what all those options were for women of a certain age that are juggling with motherhood and being a good wife and being a good daughter and having to have a successful career, because that's what it's expected of you if you're a good immigrant child, you know, you achieve all those kind of issues really.
And in it you play a woman locked into an unhappy marriage.
Yeah.
You've grown frumpy, you've got a child, your husband's trying very hard but doesn't quite understand about emancipated women, and you know, he's confused like all men are actually about this situation. And this is a powerful scene which well, we'll talk about it when we come back. Here we are.
Is Neil asleep yet?
Yeah, I'll just give him some paracetamol.
If he gets up, can you see to him? I've got a practice meeting early first thing.
Yeah, but I'll still be leaving the house before you.
Yeah, but you're a...
What? What am I, Akash?
Come to bed. Sunita?
What follows is in that sequence and a couple more times is that you actually mutilate, you self-mutilate, you slash your arm. When you reveal your arm, you've seen all the previous scars. I don't know. I mean, you always went into all this. I mean, what baffles me is self-mutilation. I mean, what is it an expression of? What is it?
It's an expression of powerlessness, actually, and it's hugely weighted towards women, unsurprisingly. It isn't suicidal.
No.
When you talk to self-harmers, they say, I feel that this is the only control I have in my life, is that I can choose to let blood. And there is something about the feeling of releasing the blood that reminds me I'm still alive. I'm not completely numb. It's very complicated, and it's a very hidden...
Very much so.
It's a very hidden phenomenon.
And you talked, obviously, to people who've done this.
Yeah.
And I mean, is it... What's the kind of recovery? Is there a recovery? I mean, what is it? Was it...
There is. I mean, it's all to do with self-esteem, and it's all
yes.
to do with people that feel totally powerless about their circumstances. And once they see a light, once they regain their independence or make choices which gets them out of whatever is making them so desperately unhappy, then of course there is recovery. But if it's not checked, it can lead to suicidal tendencies.
I mean, I don't want people to get the feeling that this is a depressing film. That's one theme in it. It is a hilarious film. I mean, there's some wonderful comic moments in it.
And that's like life, isn't it? I mean, life's completely layered like that. It's comic and tragic concerns, you know, so...
It's also, too, I mean, an expression, I suppose. In the film, there's the girl who's a successful girl, who gets away, becomes a television producer. But she's baffled because all she gets asked to do are Asian subjects. And for all the advancement that there's been, and you epitomise that, I mean, is there a sense in which you are locked into that problem as well?
Yeah, rent a gob for the Asian community.
Exactly.
Yeah, there was a danger of that happening at one point. Well, I suppose it's very difficult because on the one hand, you do want to say I'm proud of who I am, but on the other hand, you don't want Asian to be the prefix for everything.
No.
I mean, if you're an artist, you actually want to be judged on what you're doing. Woody Allen is not called the Jewish filmmaker anymore. He's just Woody Allen.
Yes.
You know, in time, his work has spoken for him. And I suppose that's the stage you want to get at, that people appreciate what you're doing. They see that you come from a particular cultural viewpoint, but it's not all that you are. It's not all that you represent.
Of course not.
And actually, who can talk for a whole community? No. That's the problem.
Well, that's right. And interesting, too, isn't it, when you look at your lifespan, about what's happened to the perception of Asians in this country in that time. I mean, you've gone from a point of being deeply unfashionable, in a sense.
Oh, we're terribly in fashion now,
You're
darling.
You're awfully in fashion now, my dear.
Brown is the new black.
Brown is, absolutely.
Yeah. Totally. The bindis are all coming out, the bangles, Bollywood, yeah. I mean, that's been going on for some time. It's hugely ironic because, you know, when I was a kid, I'm ashamed to say this, but I used to feel slightly embarrassed if I was out with my aunties and they were in their gaudy pinks and yellows with the jewellery jangling and talking really loudly in Punjabi. And I'd be like behind in my duffel coat like this. I'm not with them. I speak English right. And it's terrible when you feel like that because it's all you're negating who you are. But we were so deeply different, you know, they were like big exotic ships kind of sailing down Wolverhampton High Street, you know. And now, you know, these are the clothes that people want to wear and suddenly it's high fashion. It's very weird what happens with culture. Things go round and round and round.
Well, all the best. Meera, Syal.
Thank you very much.
Now, coming up, we'll be talking to Olivia Newton-John and again to Meera Syal. We'll see you then.
The best way to prevent falling apart is to perfect the art of heart to heart.
Tony Christie, the definitive collection. All his hits on one album. Is this the way to Amarillo? Every night I've been hugging my pillow, dreaming dreams of Amarillo. Hey, Las Vegas, can nothing save Tony Christie, the definitive collection.
'Cause I did what I did for Maria.
Out now.
She was so happy she could love no other until the time came to cook for his mother. But the Blue Dragon appeared with his expertise. There's lots I provide, from Thai to Chinese. So she cooked them all some fine cuisine. No food was left, every plate was clean. His mother, normally a dragon too, had been tamed by another, the one that is blue.
The mistress?
I can't bear not seeing you.
The lover?
It's my heart, Doctor.
His wife?
You will not make a fool of me.
And her demise.
I hoped it wouldn't come to this.
Frightfully undignified.
Ben Miller, Megan Dodds and Barbara Flynn. The drama premiere, Malice Aforethought. Sunday at 9.
Honesty pays dividends. Rainbows really do have ends.
My next guest is the singer who became a global superstar when she played Sandy in Greece. Since then, she's dealt with serious illness, failed business ventures, and divorce in the manner of a true survivor. Today, in her sixth decade, she's back on the road, touring with a new album. Ladies and gentlemen, Olivia Newton-John. You look amazing.
Thank you.
Very good.
You too.
Thank you. Golden oldies. Now, it's interesting reading about you because you've always got this milk toast and white bread stuff that's all been said about you. And that's been the image. And did you object to that at all?
I think I was just happy to have any kind of image, really. Yeah. You know, I'm sure at times I would bemoan it and, you know, go, wish I was taken seriously, as we all do when we're really young. But looking back, I'm just very grateful that I had any kind of success and image, and, you know, since then I've kind of done things to eradicate that a little bit, I think.
Well, was it difficult actually resisting temptation when you came to England? Because it was the 60s, the swinging 60s, wasn't it?
Yes, it was.
Yeah, and all that sex, drugs and rock and roll. Do you never sort of be tempted at all?
Which part of that are you asking about? think I avoided part of that. And I don't know, my friend Pat and I were a double act, and we were touring around England as young girls in a little mini bus, and seemed to manage to avoid all the drugs. I know they were there, but we didn't see them. I think we had blinders on or something, but we managed to escape okay.
You played some fairly seedy clubs too, didn't you?
Oh, very.
Tell me about them.
Very. Oh, goodness. Well, my friend Pat, who was my partner, Pat Carroll, was signed to Bernard Delphine Agency, and they were sending her out on some jobs, and we decided to join up as a double act. And we went down to this club in London, and it was kind of in a basement, and it was called Raymond's Review Bar. I don't know for those in the audience who are old enough to remember this place.
We all know Raymond's Review Bar.
But we didn't know what it was. So we were just, you know, naive in our little pink miniskirts, and went in, and we noticed that there was a girl swimming around in a fish tank behind us, kind of just with a mermaid bottom on and nothing else, and we go, this is kind of strange. We didn't really think too much about it, being young and naive as we were. Did our show to a few men in raincoats, and that was about it. And then at the end of the show, Mr. Raymond came out back and paid us cash and said, thank you very much, but I don't think it's going to work out very well for you. That was kind of the crummiest place we played. But it's kind of hilarious when I think about it now. Yeah. We had no idea what was going on.
But, I mean, then became this huge sort of superstar in the record and pop industry. And then became this huge film star. Did you ever want to be a film star?
I don't really think it was in my psyche. Singing was my thing. And I'd made a movie in Australia when I was about 16, where I just sang a song, basically, but I did a movie, and it wasn't great, and I didn't really have any great aspirations for films. I didn't really think about it. It was just music. So it all kind of happened in a marvellous way.
Well, how did you get Grease? Did you go for it? Did you audition for it? Did you say, oh, I must have that part, or what?
No, actually, yeah. I was kind of the reluctant Sandy, because I met Alan Carr, who was the producer, at a dinner party. Helen Reddy, who was a fellow Aussie, who was kind of the first Australian lady to forge her way across into England and America. And Alan Carr was the producer, and he was at dinner. And he was looking for Sandy, and I guess he'd seen me and wanted to meet me. And I was very reluctant because I'd made another movie in England at Pinewood a few years before called Tomorrow, which was a space musical in a band that was kind of put together, a la The Monkees were put together. Right. And it was a bit of a disaster again. So I thought, well, I think I'm going to leave movies out and concentrate on my music. Also, I was concerned because I was 29 and the role was for a 17-year-old. I look back now and I think, what the heck was I worried about? But at the time, I was freaked about this. So anyway, I said, you know, I'll consider doing the movie, but I'm not sure. And, you know, I'd like to do a screen test. So if you can get me a screen test with the leading man and I like it, then I'll do the movie. So the leading man was John Travolta. So it worked fine.
And I know John Travolta at that time.
No, he wasn't really known.
No, that's right, because the film that made his name had not yet been released.
That's
he'd made it. Okay. Let's be reminded, shall we, of this movie. Let's have one of the famous clips from it.
Sandy!
Tell me about it. Stir.
I got chills, they're multiplying, and I'm losing control, 'cause the power you're supplying, it's electrifying.
Can you account for the continuing cult thing around that film at all?
I do concerts, and in the front row there'll be little girls, 7, 8 years old, with their little poodle skirts and being Sandy, with their grandmothers who came to it the first time. It's really quite amazing.
How did you get into those trousers?
I wanted to ask that question.
Did you swallow a tapeworm? I mean, what?
I was really skinny. You know, I look at pictures of myself back then, and my sister and I were really, really both pretty naturally thin. And those pants did have a little stretch in them. They were actually, they were from the 50s. They were made of that shark skin material. Now, I've still got them, actually. And I wouldn't dare try and put them on now, but they were quite an amazing fabric. And the zip had gone, so they had to stitch them into, I had to be stitched into them every day. So I didn't drink anything from morning till evening, just about.
And then, of course, you had this other extraordinary episode in your life when, was it the early 90s when you had the diagnosis of cancer, with breast cancer? Your father died, your marriage broke up, you had your Koala Blue business venture went bankrupt. I mean, what else could happen to you?
It seems to happen that way, doesn't it? Things happen
well,
in three.
I don't know, does it? Yeah. I mean, you're still here, you know.
Yes, I'm still here.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Tell me about when you were diagnosed as cancer, first of all. I mean, what was your feeling at that time? Was it shock, horror? What?
Obviously fear, which is the first feeling. Fear, denial, shock, all those things you go through. And especially the first few days before you really know, has it spread anywhere else? Or, you know, what is your diagnosis going to be? And then, you know, determination that I would survive this and get through it. But, you know, I had to go through surgery and chemotherapy first. But I had a young daughter, and that was really my main focus was, you know, I need to be here for her. And didn't actually tell her about it because my best friend had lost her daughter the year before to cancer, and that little girl was Chloe's best friend. So to her, cancer meant you were going to die. So we made the decision not to tell her about it. So that was difficult, but you know, the right choice for the time.
How much do you think is the recovery, not due to, but helped by the mental attitude, by the business about, you know, this is not going to get me?
Women who feel very alone at this time very often, and it's wonderful if you can get together with a peer group, other women who have gone through it. Like my doctor, my oncologist, put me in touch with another woman who'd had the same treatment so that I could talk with her about what to expect.
And what did she say to you?
She said, it's not as bad as you imagine it's going to be. And she was already 6 months on the other side of it. She'd finished her course. And just knowing that was helpful, that she'd survived it and got through. Because I had this fear, and I know other women have gone through this. At the time, I was too embarrassed to tell anybody, but I had the fear that they would put the needle in and I would die. I would be allergic to the chemotherapy. And that was a huge fear, you know. So to get through even the first one, I was like, yes, I got through the first one. And my friend Nancy, who had lost a daughter, who was incredible support to me at the time, took me to the movie. She said, we're going to do normal things, and we're just going to go do normal stuff. And we went to a movie right away afterwards and went shopping, you know, girly stuff. And it was, you know, but like everything in life, all the difficult things you go through, they just make you stronger in the long run if you're lucky enough to survive them, so.
But at the same time, I mean, I did the catalogue there of the some things that befell you at the same time. I mean, the divorce happened as well, didn't it?
Yes.
And you come from divorced parents, and so you'd been, I suppose, aware of what could happen, so therefore being cautious about committing yourself and hoping that this was forever.
I waited to the last minute and still messed up. No, I did want to have a child, and I wasn't sure about marriage, so I kept putting it off and finally did it. But, you know, there's no guarantees in life, and it just wasn't right. But, you know, we're still friends, and we raise our daughter together. Well, she's grown now, but we have raised her together, and it was just, you know, she was the gift that came out of that marriage.
I mean, and this question is meant the best possible way. I mean, do you need a man in your life?
Well, that's a very interesting question. I've never been asked that question before.
It's quite useful to have someone to take out the rubbish and things. It is nice.
It's very nice.
The cat litter tray, I hate that.
I think need is a very strong word. You know, I think that if you've gone through very difficult things and you find out that, you know, we come in alone and we go out alone in this life, and you survive things on your own, but it's wonderful to have someone that cares for you, and I know that I have a lot of love and I'm very fortunate that way.
The problem is, of course, the successful woman, the career, and the career balanced against the man, the marriage and the children and all that. And that's the conflict that women have, isn't it?
It's tough.
Which, thank God, men don't have. It is tough, yes?
It's like the many-armed Indian goddess. You know, you're juggling. There's so many arms that you need.
Yes, I think it is it's a very difficult thing. Because, you know, I'd like to have thought, I mean, when I was first starting out and I was, you know, a singer and came to England, I thought that I was going to have the white picket fence and the dogs and the children. And it didn't actually turn out that way, and my career became this kind of a force in my life that I really loved it. You know, I really enjoyed it. And when my daughter was born, I thought I was going to retire. And when I, you know, I had cancer, I thought I was going to retire. And I think I'm going to retire every year. But there's always something. It's so stimulating and it's so interesting. And so, and you were talking before about being creative. The creative force is a very strong force. It's hard to stop. Yeah. You know, eventually there'll be a time where I just can't do it. You know, but right now, I'm really, I love it. It's fantastic, and I get to meet wonderful people and travel, and you know, it's a powerful drug.
But also, a truly strong man is never threatened by your
That's
success.
True.
A truly strong man will really support love you, you for what you're doing, actually.
That's true.
All right, now let's come up to date, right up to date, because you've done a new album.
Yes.
And it's an album of songs that have played a particular part in your life.
Yes, these songs are. I made an album as a tribute to the women singers and the songs that played a big part in my life. And going back to when I was 15 and Joan Baez, who was my idol, I used to sing Where Have All the Flowers Gone. It was the only song I could play because it was so simple, a couple of chords on guitar. And I sang that in a little coffee bar when I was a girl. And then, you know, I won my first talent contest with a song called Anyone Had a Heart, which Cilla Black sang.
Bacharach and David.
Bacharach and David.
I actually, I was in the studio when Cilla Black did her very first TV performance,
yeah.
But so you're going to sing that song. It's a lovely song, one of my favourite Bacharach David songs.
Yes,
I love it. Okay, so your band awaits you over there.
Oh, okay.
So thank Olivia you. Newton-John.
All right, thanks.
Take me in his arms and always love me.
Well, more of her in a moment. Coming up, we'll meet Lauren Bacall. See you then.
Gift of the gab or gift of the gob? Not fussed. Just trust it does the job.
It's easy to help kids get more exercise. All you have to do is get vouchers to Sainsbury's Active Kids and give it to your local school!
Nice car, mate.
New Astra Sport Hatch. Go drive.
More news.
This is a historical day.
More reaction.
It's just been total shock.
More analysis.
Did you get it wrong?
The ITV Lunchtime News is now longer, bringing you even more in-depth coverage of all the issues that matter, both internationally and locally.
The extended Lunchtime News, weekdays, 12:30.
The way he gabbles, the way he garbles, he must think I've lost me marbles.
My final guest is the last reminder of the golden era of Hollywood. She's been a star for more than 60 years. Her very first film defined her style, began one of the great Hollywood romances, and introduced the world to an actress who became an icon of a time when real men looked like Humphrey Bogart and women could whistle.
It's even better when you help. Sure you won't change your mind about this?
Uh-huh.
This belongs to me and so do my lips. I don't see any difference.
Oh, I do.
Okay. You know you don't have to act with me, Steve. You don't have to say anything and you don't have to do anything. Not a thing. Oh, maybe just whistle. You know how to whistle, don't you, Steve? You just put your lips together and blow.
Ladies and gentlemen, Lauren Bacall.
What haunts me?
What haunts you?
What haunts me is that line.
It's a great line.
I know it is a great line, isn't it?
That is a great line.
Well, there are no repeats, you know.
There are no repeat fees.
There are no repeats.
No, they.
No, just... I mean, you can't get away from some things in your life, and that's one of them.
You won't want to get away from that. That's a magnificent moment of sense. It's an iconic moment.
And my life, after all.
But when you... What is wonderful about that scene, of course, is that quite obviously the two actors there are in love with each other. You can actually, it's not hindsight, you can see it. There's a kind of chemistry between the two of you there that's absolutely irresistible.
I guess so. It did lead to one or two other things.
And that famous, is it true that, well, I know it's true, but that famous look that you gave there, that wasn't contrived, was it? That was done out of...
Not at all. That was an accident of mine because I was so nervous all through the making of this movie, particularly at the beginning. I was so nervous that my head used to shake. And I was like this, you know. And I found that the only way, and it's absolutely true, the only way I could keep my head still was by holding it down and then looking up without moving. Then I was okay. And it developed into this thing that was named by either Hawks or the studio, or I have no idea. I didn't name it, but suddenly it was the look.
Yeah, it's wonderful. It defined
I'm not beefing about it. Listen, it was good while it lasted. Yeah. I look a little silly doing it now.
Well, what was interesting too was the way that, as I was saying earlier when I was talking to Oliva and to Meera, that the men that you married, including Bogey, I mean, insisted that you actually gave up your career.
It wasn't a question of insistence. I mean, Bogey said to me, no, but he didn't tell me to give it up. He said, if you want a career, if you really want to focus on a career, I will do everything I can to help you. But I will not marry you. Because he'd been married to three actresses, three failures, and they'd put their careers first. And I, of course, said, oh, I won't put my career first. He said, I want a wife. He said, I love you, I want to marry you, but I want you with me. No location. I promised him that I would never go on location away from him. And I kept that promise. And I'm damn glad that I kept the promise to stay with him. I mean, I wouldn't let him go to Africa without me. I was not about to do that. I mean, you know, there were places I wanted to go and things I wanted to see. But he never insisted. I continued to work, but I worked when I was in California.
Yes.
At home.
Yes, yes.
And when he went on location, I almost always went with him.
And of course, you weren't to know either, too, that the time that you did spend together was going to be a short time, basically.
Yes, very short, and thank God I made that decision. But it was never insistence, and it was never like turning into the little woman and the thing and the thing and the thing. I never... I'm too big to be the little woman. And with Jason, that
Jason
was my
Robots.
Choice again.
Yeah.
He didn't insist on anything, but I just, except, well, anyway.
Which is not in the book.
No, not in the book.
No.
But I just decided that I had to pay attention. And after all, I had two small children. Why wouldn't I pay attention anyway?
But you see, he was an alcoholic, and Bogey was a difficult man, too. You like these
but
strong...
Bogey was difficult, but Bogey was never an alcoholic.
No, I know that.
But there is nobody that is interesting, that is not difficult. Like you, Michael.
How do you know?
I sense it.
You sense it. And you're quite right. You're quite right. Your antennae in perfect working order, I have to tell you, Mr. Cole. But what's interesting in your book is when you describe Bogey's illness. We were talking to the girls about the problem with cancer, and he died in denial, in a sense. I mean, he would not...
Well, not to himself, I don't think.
No, but to people around him.
I mean, I think the person who is ill makes the decision. If you are ill and you decide that you don't want to discuss it, that you want to continue as though everything's going to be okay... And as far as we were concerned, everything was going to be okay. Then I think you just have to follow along.
Yes.
I mean, I was not about to sit there and say, well, what do you think is going to happen? Do you think, you know?
Yes.
Never. And you have to respect that choice.
Yes.
And go along with it. And that's what I did. And that's what he did. I mean, he only said, he was kind of a shut-in the last 4.5 months of his life. He couldn't... go out anywhere or anything. And I think about the last month, the children used to come in at the end of the day and kind of play in our room and stuff. And he said, I'd rather they didn't come in here. He didn't want to be remembered looking not well and not being able to function well with them. And so, okay.
Again, the thing that goes through your book is you say that the sense of humor that you have has been the most important attribute you've carried with you through your life.
If you don't make me laugh, I don't want to know you.
But also, too, I mean, and if you'd tell it if you would, because it's just a lovely line, the humor you found in the worst possible moment of your life after Bogey had died with the flowers.
Oh, the flowers, yes. I guess, yes, it's very peculiar, this world. No, after Bogey died, I had, a statement was released to, if you care to make any contributions to cancer research, please send it to, you know, Fund Cancer Research. I don't know whether I said, don't buy flowers. I don't think I said.
Don't send flowers.
Or don't send flowers. Yeah. Just send your contribution to cancer research. Whereupon, I received a telegram from the Floral Association of Southern California saying, why did you say don't send flowers? We're not going to see any of your movies anymore. So, of course, it made me laugh because I couldn't believe it. But then again, there are so many things in L.A. that I don't believe.
So. let's come right up to date, because, I mean, in your final chapter, you wrote your autobiography a long time ago, and now you've updated it now.
No, you do not update your life.
Well, you added another chapter then.
Yeah, yes, you add to it. The missing years are added to.
I've got a sense there's more to come as well, actually.
Oh, I don't know.
you say that it was an extraordinary time. I mean, it was. You can romance it if you like. But the fact of the matter is, when you start listing the people who were around you, like, you know, Gershwin and Cole Porter, and then the great stars Spencer Tracy and Cary Grant and Gregory Peck and all that, and then the writers that you knew, George Axelrod and all those people. I mean, these are huge, huge names in the industry. But more importantly, of course, in those days, they were protected from the rest of the world, in a sense, weren't they? From nowadays, stars are...
Well, more, yes. Well, I think the studio system was actually a better system than everyone going off in all directions.
Yes.
Because the studio, they wanted to control us. And in a way, they did, because they had a big publicity set up and they controlled you through the press. They planned, you know, some of the smarter studio heads planned a career and tried to build a career. Jack Warner was not one of those fellows, by the way. But it was good. I mean, we were protected. They found a way always to get Errol Flynn out of trouble from his escapades on a sailboat with a 17-year-old girl. And, you know, all that kind of stuff.
But the difference is nowadays that they're in this under this microscope immediately. I mean, for instance, take an example. Two people you knew very well indeed, Katie Hepburn and Spencer Tracy. Now, the two biggest stars in the universe had this affair which lasted, what, 20-odd years?
Well, it wasn't an affair. Well, it was much more than an affair.
Well, but did the rest of us know?
No.
Well, precisely. Now, can you imagine the feeding frenzy that would be now if they were two comparable stars?
What happened in the case of Spence and Katie is that they lived their lives very, very privately. They never went out in public together, never. They went out separately if they went out at all. Katie was never one to go to openings, neither was Spencer, so you never saw it. There was none of this red carpet stuff going on there anyway at that time. And Katie also appeared on the stage. She went to London to be in a play,
yeah. So
she was gone for several months, and then she went to Broadway to be in a play, and then Spence made movies, and he went on location and so forth. So people that knew them well knew about their gigantic love for one another and total dedication to one another. But they never, ever wanted to embarrass his wife, who was less than charming to Katie when Spencer died. So I really think it was their brilliant handling of their own lives. They kept it quiet themselves.
Now, Lauren, you know that there were journalists who knew about it and didn't print the story. That's the difference.
Well, also they didn't because it wasn't flaunted. I mean, today everyone wants to have their picture taken. They want, and then they suddenly get annoyed because it's an invasion of privacy. Excuse me, you're going to go to every opening and be seen everywhere together. Seen, and you're married here, and you're going out with this guy, and the guy's going out with another girl. But please, well, of course they write about it. Anything that you do in public is fair game for the press. But what you do in private is not.
Right. Okay, we're going to talk some more.
Shall we talk it up? All right, let's
see. You want to talk it up? All right, we'll do that in just a moment when we take a short break while we make the money to go on doing this show.
Wow.
All right. Back in a moment with more from Lauren Bacall, Olivia Newton-John and Meera Syal. We'll see you then.
If your tongue's a yo-yo, that's a no-no.
There's nothing you and I won't do. I'll stop the world and melt with you.
You pick the phone, you fix the monthly bill, so you always know what's coming. You fix from T-Mobile.
Hey, Herman. What's that?
It's a server.
A server?
An on-demand IBM e-server. It can monitor itself, manage itself, optimize itself, protect itself, practically heal itself.
How'd it get here?
Maybe it ordered itself.
Self-optimizing IBM e-server X series with Intel Xeon processors.
This week inside Scotland on Sunday, a fantastic 30,000 Ryanair flight giveaway. Fly direct from Glasgow Prestwick to London, Ireland and Germany. Plus, fly to Dublin from Edinburgh for £1 and from Aberdeen for only 50p. All you pay is the taxes and charges. Claim your no-fare Ryanair flights exclusively with Scotland on Sunday.
Some of these plants were potted in Westland multipurpose compost with added johninis, and the rest in leading competitors.
Daydream. I fell asleep amid the flowers.
4 weeks later, the results speak for themselves. Westland, making British gardens healthier.
Clayton, it is not complex. It's about the deals. And why the stage block? You are a thespian tiger.
Whence my motivation, Artie?
Avoiding another season of Panto in Rill.
Now at Arnold Clark, a 41-point service is only £69, and a 41-point service with MOT only £89. It's about the deals.
Artie!
Get a free sex educational DVD with a Sunday Sport this Sunday. The complete guide to sexual ecstasy, absolutely free.
Warning, couples who watch this explicit DVD together may become highly aroused.
So make sure you get your copy of the Sunday Sport this Sunday and get your copy of the complete guide to sexual ecstasy on DVD, absolutely free.
Get a free salsa lesson or DVD with new fragrance Surf Tropical. So come on, girls, salsa your socks off.
Sport SPL. All the goals, all the action, all the matches. The best of Scottish football on Scotsport SPL. Sunday at 10:45.
What was that cheesy grin you fed her? She won't believe you then. Hard cheddar.
Living room.
You danced with who?
I danced with Gene Kelly once. Well, it wasn't a real dance. It was kind of a presentation of All of Us Here to Stay while, I don't know, Harold Arlen or one of those fellows was playing the song
on
the piano in Ira Gershwin's house.
Oh,
and we did a little improvisation.
Was Cole Porter there by any chance?
No, he wasn't at the Gershwin house. He had his own group.
Uh-huh, yeah. What a life,
eh?
You danced with Gene Kelly?
I did, yeah, in Xanadu.
Yeah. Gene Kelly and Travolta, that's not a bad window,
not
but
bad,
is it?
Is
no.
it?
Not too bad.
No. I've danced with my Uncle Balbinder.
No. And is he good?
He's brilliant at Bhangra.
At Bhangra. What's that?
That's Bhangra.
Bhangra.
Yeah. Give you a lesson.
There's so few men know how to dance, you know.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, do you know how?
Oh, I know I've got two left feet, but I would have learned for you. I really
oh, honey, it's not too late.
I know, but we'll try.
Well, they say you can tell a lot about a man from the way he dances, because if he's good at dancing...
Is that true?
You mean he's good
You've
at...
just said you got two left feet, though, haven't you?
Yeah, but...
Sorry.
I did get rather sexy eventually. Thank God I didn't instigate this one, right? Which reminds me, did the casting couch play any part in Hollywood in your days?
How dare you ask that? Are you suggesting?
No, I'm not for a moment, but as an observer of the scene.
Oh, no. But the casting couch, I mean, there were always rumors. I mean, there were many people who were girlfriends of executives at studios that was not known to the public. And they may have gotten a part or two that they might not have had, had it not been for that.
Yes.
But I specifically did not know of any.
No.
You know, you must not guess at those things.
You must not, indeed.
You must be sure.
Absolutely. Otherwise, but about predatory men, because in your book, you do tell of a meeting that you had with a film star called Robert Montgomery.
Yes, well,
I mean, here we're all.
What can I tell you? I know. Well, I was invited. I arrived in Hollywood. I was 18 years old. Then, well, I guess it was I had turned 19 by then or whatever. But I was taken by my agent and his wife to this enormous party that was given by Elsa Maxwell with 100 people. Every movie star on the face of the earth was there. And I was sitting in a corner in my little dress. They were all in their gowns and everything. That was glamour time. I was not glamorous. I was in a little kind of gold-colored silk dress that was buttoned all the way up and stuff with long sleeves, low-heeled shoes, and I was sitting in a corner. And I'd always had a crush on Robert Montgomery.
He's a very handsome man.
Very attractive. And I loved him in movies. I thought he was great in comedies and so forth. Very attractive. And I found that I was introduced to him. And I was so beyond thrilled, but so nervous. And I don't know, either he was walking me out or he said, come out here with me or something like that. But we ended up walking in the same direction at one point. And he said, would you give me your phone number? And I thought, oh, he wants my phone number. I was so naive. Today would be a different thing. Entirely other story. And so I gave him my phone number. And he looked at me and said, too easy.
Oh. What a shit.
What a way to treat an innocent young girl who just comes to Hollywood just trying to get along. Look what happened.
I'd have taken you off to Barnsley immediately.
Disillusioned immediately.
Oh dear, what a fascinating life you've led.
I know, what a fascinating life of rejection I've had.
Oh, you're looking wonderful, and it's good to see you again, as always. And the book Lauren Bacall, By Myself and Then Some.
Yes, that's...
And then
there
some.
There you go.
Is the extra words that you have penned. Lauren Bacall, as ever, thank you very much indeed. Oliva and John, thank you very much indeed. And Meera, Syal, thank you very much indeed.
Very tasty.
My thanks to Lauren Bacall, to Oliva and John, and to Meera Syal. From all of us here, a very good night. Good night.
Next tonight, it's the ITV Weekend News. Then at 11:30, Gene Hackman stars in her late movie, Narrow Margin.